Hi guys, this is Gus from Behringer and I have with me two very important things. One is the WING personal mixer, our brand new mixing console, and the other one is Jan Duve. He's the head of and governor, knows it all about the WING, so we can poke and pry him and get all the information and all the details out of him. And this is what we want to do in this video, have a look at the new console and talk about all the functionality in detail.
Yeah, thanks for getting me in.
Okay, so I would say let's start with the hardware and the control surface. What's the hardware like? What are the features? And most of all, what's the concept behind the hardware?
Sure. Can I have a word on X32 up front? Because many people are expecting this to be a successor model. We don't see it quite that way. We will still maintain the X32 series as well as we do maintain the XR mixer series. And there's still room for something below the XR mixes, maybe. We see...
Hint, hint. So X32 won't go away and will still be supported. And we're, by the way, we're still working on the update of the update, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Speaking about the personal mixing console, the subtitle was, of course, chosen on purpose because we've thought we would not just come up with something that has more channels or more effects or anything. We wanted to come up with a console that provides more individuality to the engineer who's operating it. So there needs to be possibilities for tailoring the surface to his specific needs. We need to ensure that the complete user interface is extremely responsive. So we have touch-sensitive rotary controls, we have a multi-touch touch screen, three fader banks, which is pretty obvious here, that can all be configured totally freely. And we have a much larger and more powerful custom control section. We have the channel editing section with also lots of touch sensitivity. Everything is extremely responsive based on our own real-time operating system. Just to make the engineer feel right, feel at home, and being capable of tailoring the surface in a way that suits his needs and not ours.
This is why it's called personal, because you can tailor it to your personality, to the way you work, and it's really, really flexible. Okay. Exactly. So for me as an engineer, the most important thing is always to have a look at the backside and have a look at the connections, and I think this is what we are going to do next, turn the thing around and have a look at the I/O.
Sure. We have 48 input channels, and all of them can be stereo channels, so that makes 96 signals in mix. And of course, we didn't build in 96 microphone preamps here. Nobody would do so. So we reduced the amount of analog I/O to 8 aux in and outputs and 8 very high-quality Midas Pro series mic preamps. So we reduced the amount, but we didn't compromise the quality. And it's also got 8 Pro series XLR outputs. Along with it, we have an expansion slot for various formats. Currently, the console is shipping with a dual SD card recorder, WING Live. A little bit different from the X Live, actually, because we have two separate controllers controlling the SD cards, which allows us to run 32-track recording or playback on both completely separately.
So you could have one card recording and one card for playback, for example.
Uh-huh. Yes, exactly. So the interface towards the console is 64 channels wide, and expansion cards for Mahdi and Dante, for example, will follow. And they offer 64 by 64 channels as well. So that's double the capacity of X32 expansion cards. Mm-hmm. Then we have three AS50 connections, because less local I/O means more outboard I/O. And especially since everything is stereo, from input channels to buses to outputs, we need lots of interfacing. That's 144 channels of inputs and outputs on AS50 streams. Plus we have a USB interface with 48 by 48 channels. And we have two Ethernet ports and an internal switch, which could be added an internal option card for Dante or SoundGrid, for example, and then the console speaks natively 64 channels of audio over IP. So all in all, that, except one thing that I forget, the total number is 374 inputs and outputs that can be interfacing with the console, can be patched to any channel or can be transferred from an input to an output directly, if you like.
Mm. So to explain this a little bit for people who are still used to having the analog multicore, I mean, you could do the very small club gig with the mixer alone, because there are a couple of microphones, you could hook in a couple of keyboards, there's all the analog out for the speakers, of course. But this class of console usually deals with much more I/O, and then it's much more practical to have a digital stage box, and even a small one. I mean, throw it next to the drum riser, connect all the microphones, and then have a single networking cable that's affordable, that has a great quality.
Absolutely, and especially in terms of signal integrity, it makes a lot of sense to keep the microphone cables as short as possible, because the cable always introduces a capacity and degrades the signal quality, plus the risk that individual cables may break. So keeping the microphone cables as short as possible makes a lot of sense, and then have a long Cat5 cable connection between the stage and the front of house console is very convenient, and that's basically current state of the art. That's how you do things.
And you can do other sexy stuff, for example, like the Midas DP48 personal monitoring. I think you did a video on the Midas channel explaining how it works. This will also run over AES50, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Well, that's why we have three ports in total. So there's a lot of I/O stage box connectivity plus monitoring systems could be separated. They can also be daisy chained, but sometimes this makes more sense if they are connected to parallel, rather.
And what if I already have an X32 with digital stage boxes? Could I upgrade to WING and replace the X32 with WING and continue to use my digital stage boxes?
Yes, of course, you absolutely can. All the signals can be routed through the AES50 ports and shared with other consoles, can be taken from stage boxes or sent to stage boxes to the monitoring system. That's all compatible.
And then I think you mentioned one, or you didn't mention it, there's one secret connection there still on the WING. So let's talk about that.
It's not quite a secret, because it's clearly labeled, and it's the white area that you see on the rear panel.
Well, it says SC, that stands for secret connection, of course.
Oh, yeah. Almost, yeah. So we read this as Stage Connect, which is a new interface that Clark Technic developed. And that's really exciting in our eyes, because for me, this is the future of XLR. A standard microphone cable has an input and an output, and there's just one signal transferring from the female connector to the male connector. Now, we changed the game in the way that we can transfer 32 channels, and not only in one direction, we can have multiple setups of directions, so 24 in and 8 out, or
16 in and out.
Yeah, whatever. Mm-hmm. It could be anything. That's configuring automatically. The master device is detecting all the daisy chain devices on the bus and seeing how many inputs do I have and how many outputs, and then configuring the bus. And not only can we transfer audio and 24-bit audio in very, very low latency, we can also transfer power over it, 18 watts. And we can transfer control data, so the master device knows what other devices are connected. So that makes huge flexibility for future stage boxes, maybe personal monitoring systems, maybe DI boxes or breakout boxes, like the one that you have.
Yeah, speaking of the future, this is an engineering sample. This has a Stage Connect input and output, because you can daisy chain them, and it has eight XLR inputs and eight XLR outputs. Yeah. Typical scenario. Side rack?
Yeah, for example, if you think that the WING doesn't have sufficient analog I/O for your outboard equipment or for inner monitoring transmitters or wireless receivers, those are usually located not directly on the console but in a side rack, and that's where you put your breakout box, like this one, 8x8, could be 16x16. Up to 32 channels can be exchanged with a side rack with just one XLR microphone cable connection and no external power supply required.
I think the craziest thing starts when you add up all the connections. When you add up the 32 channels of Stage Connect plus the 144 connections of over AS50, the analog built-in connections, the connections over USB and so forth and so forth. And I think it's 374,
yes.
Is it? Yeah, 374 inputs and 374 outputs. And to manage all of them, you guys have developed a new system with sources,
yes.
And I think we'll have a look at that now.
Sources in our eyes are more than just input numbers, because we think about it as something that gives a meaning to what is the musical purpose that you actually want to convey. And that's, say, the lead singer or bass drum signal needs to be transferred to the PA system somehow or to the recording system. We ramped up the inputs with additional properties. So the input has authority over gain and phantom power, obviously. There's specific metering. It has got its own mute. It can have additional properties like color, icon, name, and even tags. So that is representing the purpose of what the signal is about. And that can be handled inside the console for attaching it to a channel and then applying processing in a channel or sending it to an output directly or recording it or giving it to another console. So you always refer to the real purpose rather than to numbers. And especially since we have so much digital connectivity, you would end up in just juggling with numbers and making sure that everybody understands where input 37 on the second AS50 stream is going and what it is doing. We remove all this by assigning it a purpose, and that purpose is the anchor point that we call source inside the wing. That's a major difference from other consoles, so you have to understand, yeah, there is a source, and if I have defined the source, I can apply it to channels and use it somewhere else.
And there's also a Wing companion app, which allows you to set up the sources on a tablet.
Yeah, so you Copilot.
Copilot, it's called Copilot. And I mean, imagine like this, you're on stage, you're doing the connections next to the drum riser, for example, and you can immediately add everything on the tablet, and the second engineer, for example, can already work on the console.
Yeah, and you don't have to communicate that knowledge on a sheet of paper, for example.
Yeah.
The moment that you assign a specific input, these properties, the guy on the front of house console already sees, yeah, that's a bass drum, obviously. Mm-hmm. It has the icon, the color, and the name, and even the tags. Speaking about the tags, they can be used in various ways. We currently use them for automatically grouping signals to, say, a DCA or a muke group. So all the drum signals that carry the tag drum will automatically be controlled by the drum mute group or the drum DCA. Mm-hmm. So using the same tags will automatically run these grouping functions. Could also be used for filtering in the later stage when you need to get an overview of all the horns or whatever. You can just immediately see where they are and where you could take them from to assign them to channels.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now I have all my sources assigned. I assign the sources to channels and then I go into mixing. So I would say, let's have a look.
Let's apply some processing.
Yeah,
of course. The first thing is to go to the input page where you select your source. You will see we have two sources. There's a main source and an alternative source, like in inline console. Then there is a trim and a balance control for adjusting, because all these sources and inputs can be stereo inputs. That's also one of the properties of this source, that it's, you know, if it's a stereo keyboard that you're transferring or a mono bass drum. Mm-hmm. And whenever you use it and apply it to a channel, automatically, if it's a mono source, the channel would be used in mono. If it's a stereo source, the channel is a stereo channel and you don't have to think about it because it's a source property. If it is a stereo signal coming in, then you need to maybe balance the left, right, and the trim a little bit. There's also an input delay that allows time adjustments when multiple microphones are open and there's some cross bleed between them. You can align them properly. We also have filters in every channel. In every input channel, we have low cut and high cut filters, plus something we call a tool filter, which could be all pass filtering, a sound maxer, or a tilt filter. Mm-hmm. And that's available in any channel, plus the six-band EQ that comes on top. Mm. The EQ is also very interesting because it allows you to solo individual bands before applying any gain changes. So if you spot there's a nasty frequency that you want to get rid of, you don't have to emphasize this frequency just to find the proper way position of the frequency.
While the concert is already running.
Yeah, and everybody notices, oh, there's something nasty going on. Mm-hmm. You would like to do this inaudibly for the audience. So using the band solo helps you doing this. select a band, go on band solo, and then you will just listen to that band on your monitoring cue.
Mm-hmm. And you can do it from the touchscreen, from the knobs, or from the channel strip section.
Exactly. We have a channel strip section with controls for each of the main processing steps. Mm-hmm. That allows you to get very quickly to individual or the most important parameters of that section, say gate, compressor, filters, or EQ. Could be used independent from the main display when the main display, for example, somebody is working on the scene management or something and you don't want to interrupt that, mm-hmm. you can still select a channel and change the channel properties and the channel strip details. Mm-hmm. It's also giving loads of information about the status of the channel, where it's coming from, which source, is it mono stereo, is there delay on, is it sending to main, etc., etc. Mm-hmm. All that information is very obvious and clean and mm-hmm. in a small spot.
But plugins.
Plugins, yes. Yeah. There's two things about plugins.
Okay.
We have very high quality wing dynamics, like gates, compressors, and EQs. But if you think that you want to get a specific vibe to it that only a specific EQ can bring or a specific compressor type can bring, you can swap this out to a bunch of very high class emulations of expensive outboard gear. And that's not taking up any load from the effects engine because it's still happening in the channel.
Mm-hmm. So how many plugins could you technically have as a maximum on a single channel?
Per channel?
Yeah.
That could be five.
Five.
Because we have two dynamic slots, we have the EQ slot, mm-hmm. plus we have two insert points, mm-hmm. and all of them could carry plugins in one or the other fashion, depending on what you need.
So you could exchange the gate for a drama gate, style gate,
sure.
you could have an LA-2A as a compressor, you could have a British style EQ, and then on top, maybe a delay or a chorus, things like that.
Yes, yeah. Could be delay chorus, but uh-huh. we also have some of the dynamics processors in the effects blocks or the EQs. So if, for example, you want to use the 6-band parametric EQ for some technical adjustments and then add a pull tech emulation for giving it a specific vibe, and because you are used to use that mm-hmm. sort of effect, then you can just insert both EQs.
Yeah. I saw the DSP chips on the board. So how high is the processing power compared to X32?
All in all, it's probably 4 or 5 times more mm-hmm. processing under the hood.
Mm-hmm. Of course, next to the sound, it boils down to, does the product have enough I/O? And can I work my way? Is it really flexible when I'm doing the job? I mean, maybe we should end with talking about the flexibility of the surface. We're already assigning things to channels. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, we spoke about sources to be assigned to channels, mm-hmm. and now the channels can be assigned to fader layers. Obviously, when the console ships, it comes with the predefined fader layers that are printed on the buttons. And there are, as you know, there's on every fader layer, there's two user layers that are completely freely configurable. And if I say freely, it's really free. It's not only associating specific channels with each other. We can also include a boost send for a specific channel next to that channel fader. So it could be, say, the lead singer on fader 7, and on fader 8, I could have the lead singer's reverb send next to it. Mm-hmm. It could also be an effect parameter that I put on a fader. So that's really flexible. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, everything on every fader layer could be reconfigured that way. But that's something for the experts. that's why we give it a separate mode, so that the average user still has the fader layers to come back to. There's also a very nifty way of going to specific channels on the fader board. Even if you screwed up all your channel assignments totally, mm-hmm. and you got lost, there's a metering screen showing all the input and output metering. And if you touch one of these blocks, it immediately calls up that fader section in the middle section of the console. So no matter how the fader layout was screwed up or changed, you can also always get that signals back to the center section.
And I think there is much, much more regarding flexibility. There are a lot of things we didn't even talk about. For example, in the custom controls, you can assign one button to tap in always the delay tempo. You can have one button to mute always a specific channel. You can have one button that starts your DAW over MIDI. And you can even have, because the console has GPIO ports, you have a dedicated button to switch on the stage light or to power on the coffee machine. Theoretically. So what we like to know from you guys is, what questions do you have about the console? Leave a comment in the comments, which makes sense. Please like the video. Thanks, Jan. Thanks for watching, and talk to you soon.
Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, guys. Bye.